Okay, so let's now begin the actual syllabus. Now, as you see from the course outline, the course is about microprocessors and electronics and microprocessors. Now, you might be wondering why you, mechanical engineering students, are doing this course. And you see, even though you're a mechanical or might be civil, I'm not sure, but even though you are not electronic students or you're not E&E students, you still need to have some familiarity with the concepts of electronics and microprocessors. And that's why this course was created. Now, this course originally or up until earlier this year, I mean, you can say up until February this year or up until December 2019, this course used to be designed and developed and taught by members of the E&E department. So it was focused on concepts or principles of the E&E department, such as electrical circuit designs, circuit development design, etc., etc. But in last year, an effective in December 2019, this course has been modified to fit the requirements or the needs of mechanical engineering students. See, as a mechanical engineering student, once you graduate, you won't be required to develop an electrical circuit. You won't be required to design and configure controllers. Don't get me wrong, you might be involved with electronic systems, but not in the capacity of doing the work that the E&E student is trained to do. So we changed this course, or this course was modified in order to fit the requirement of the mechanical engineering students. So what does that mean? So first of all, you would need to have some familiarity with E&E concepts, and that's where we are here. So you'll have to have some familiarity with concepts, and so that later on when you are joining or you are doing some discussion or some brainstorming sessions with people from different departments, at the very least, you would have some foundational understanding of E&E concept of the microprocessors and electronics. This way, when you talk to someone from the E&E department or from the electrical and electronic background, the topics or the concept will not sound too foreign for you. So this way you will have, at the very least, some basic foundation to you. Second of all, you would then, or this is the second part. Now, after that, you will still need to be able to do some work with microprocessors and electronics. I said earlier that you won't be required to design the microprocessors yourself, but you still need to work with it. And what do you mean by work with it? Work with it means that you need to be able to interact with it, program it to do a job, connect it to a circuit, and then use it to do a system. And this definitely is something that you would need. Up until last year, up until 2019, most of our final year engineering students, once they reach the final year project, FYP, as well as once they reach capstone projects, they always face the same challenge. They always face the fact that they have to build electromechanical systems that would involve programming, that would involve controllers and microprocessors. But they have zero knowledge in these areas because they were not trained on them. So that's yet another purpose of this course, or at this current version of it. This course is designed specifically for mechanical engineering students, by mechanical engineering students, to then to allow you to help you or to help the students to be able to interact with electromechanical systems. So you would be able to work with controllers such as Arduino and by right Raspberry Pi, but unfortunately in the virtual version of this course, we're only gonna focus on Arduino only. And then you will be able to do programming, circuit development, as well as deployment of the system. The second major part of this course is IoT, or the Internet of Things. Not only are we going to be building electromechanical systems, but we're also going to be working with electromechanical system for IoT. So obviously, you will need to know what that is. And once again, IoT, historically speaking, is usually taught by the E&E department. even though that the majority of application in the industry, the biggest users of the applications of IoT are mechanical engineers by definition. Industrial Revolution, IR4, robotics, IoT robotics or iRobotics, AI, and a bunch of other things that mechanical engineers work with directly are very, more and more IoT is involved. So you as a mechanical engineering student, you need to know what IoT is and how to use it. And again, from the point of view of mechanical engineering. And that's why, or that's the purpose of this course. So once again, the concept or the purpose of this course is to introduce you to the concept of electronics and microprocessors with a special focus on practical application. And then also we talk about embedded system, microcontrollers, and IoT applications. I don't like to talk about myself, but I would have to because I would have to explain relevance or my relevance to this course and why am I actually involved here. I'm going to talk about only my brief involvement with IoT. And this is not supposed to open here. Just one second. Okay, so some of you don't know me, some of you know me. So actually, I am a professional engineer, IR, and I am a chartered engineer as well, and senior member of IEEE, which is only for E&E engineers, and also I'm a certified IEEE specialist. I did actually work, or actually I have been working on IoT since 2016, that's 4 years already, during which I had developed a number of projects. By the way, you will see those in the course. I have obtained a number of patents on IoT, and me and my teams won a number of awards in international events on IoT. We have patents, papers, publications, and funding on projects on IoT. However, my educational background is mechanical engineering. Manufacturing engineering, actually. Manufacturing engineering specific / mechanical. So even though my educational background is mechanical engineering just like you, I actually am specialized in IoT for my research as well as on my robotics. In fact, my other course that I teach in this university is robotics and automation. But that course is a year four course. It's an elective course. When you reach the final year, then you can enroll there. But just to let you know, that robotics course, the requirement for that course is this course, the one you're in right now, or the E&M. Excuse me. So essentially, you can say that by the time you finish this course, you'll be able to do programming, controllers, IoT. So that by if you join me again in the elective course in robotics, then we can do robotics design, and so on and so forth. You know what I mean? So this is about me. Don't want to talk about myself again. And now we talk about the course itself. So as I said, according to the class plan, we were supposed to talk about, not this one, no. Where did it go? This one. So fundamentals, we're going to cover it today, and maybe we're going to talk about IoT also, and then next week we'll talk about embedded. Basically today and next week, by the end of next week's session, we will finish these three topics, which is fundamentals, then embedded systems, and IoT. They are not in any particular order, and the topics are interconnected, so you might see me jumping from here to here to here, basically jumping from fundamentals to embedded to IoT, because they are sometimes interconnected. So do not pay attention much to the order of things, and so on and so forth. And again, this content that I'm talking about right now is already on Moodle. You can download yourself. Let's go back here. So you can download the chapter one and the notes for your own time, and then you can actually study it on your own time. Same thing for two and for three as well. Okay, so let's begin with the course, the content of the lecture. So, by the way, Kishan Rao is my master student now, and he was also your senior, he studied also here. He took with me robotics, machine design. I used to teach machine design and theory of machines. My courses are still on Moodle, by the way, on machine design and Tom. And he took Tom, machine design, robotics, and another course, and he scored A plus in all of them. And he did my, he's doing masters right now with me. He's about to finish, and maybe PhD later. So he worked a lot with on development of this course, and he's basically, and he also helped me or worked with me on a number of projects on IoT as well, and even in the development of the training material as well. So it's a very good example of what you can do right now. And by the way, he is now employed in an oil-based company here in Malaysia. And recently, me and him, we were invited by a company here to develop for them an IoT system and with a great budget. So I can tell you right now that the market for IoT is just wild. And it's a very good idea for a mechanical engineer to capture this market and capitalize on it. Okay, so fundamentals. So we're going to talk about the following concepts. By the time we finish this, all of these concepts, you will have good familiarity or understanding what these concepts are. What do you mean by electrical and electronics, and why they are separated like that, or what is the difference between them? What's a CPU? I understand some of you might have some familiarity with some of these terms, but familiarity or general term familiarity is not the same as full understanding. So you might know what a CPU is, but then we need to understand what is the difference between CPU and microprocessor, and what are the different types between versions of microprocessors. What do you mean by hardware abstraction? What's the difference between a program and an algorithm? And what do you mean by a syntax? And what is that? Online resources. And this is the concepts that we're going to be talking about now. By the way, I'm going to be explaining concepts, but if you have any questions at any time, you can just unmute yourself and ask the questions. Unfortunately, I won't be able to see the messages you guys post because it's not, I have multiple screens, and I'm looking at this screen here that you're looking at right now, and I'm not looking at the other monitor. So I might not even see the message. So if you have any question, just unmute yourself at any time and just say, excuse me, sir, and then go ahead and ask your question. Okay, so let's get going. Let me mute that. It's my notifications from my WhatsApp. So let me just mute that a little bit. Okay, so electrical and electronic system. Now, electrical systems are everywhere around us, and you can see it at homes, schools, and systems, and everywhere. However, it's very important to understand the difference between electrical and electronic. Electrical in general is where we talk about distribution and the contribution of electricity or electrical power. I think the key word that we should need to focus on is right here. Home, and let's go here. You know what? I want to use a different color, a nice color. I want to talk about this right now. You see, what do you mean by keyword? You see, although this course contains a significant amount of hands-on, such as programming and circuit development, we do have a considerable amount of theory and theory questions. What does that mean? You have assignments 1, 2, and 3, and you have the tests. These will be primarily theoretical questions. You might be familiar with math or mathematical operations. You might be comfortable in writing formulas and drawing diagrams, but you might not be familiar with writing essays or writing a theoretical solution. You might not have a good command of English. You might not be able to write a lot, or you don't like to memorize a lot of stuff. I agree with all of that, by the way, and I was just like that in college, except for the English part. But then this is why when you understand the concept of the keyword, then you would know that this is the primary word that we would be looking for. When we actually mark your solution, whether it's an assignment or a test, we don't care about how much volume you write. Some people think that if I write 3 pages of solution, I will get 4 marks. No, I am sorry to tell you that even if you write 10 pages of solution, I will be happy to read it all. Okay, not happy, but I will have to read it all. The thing is, we don't care about volume. We care about the keywords. So if you want your answers, or you want to be have a precise way answering, or excuse me, of obtaining the marks, you'll have to identify the keywords first. And this is the keyword. Let's say the question asks you, what is the difference between electrical and electronic system? The keyword is right here, that electrical system focus on the distribution and the transmission of electrical power. Okay, now the rest of the paragraph you see here is just explanation. Sir, can I just write electrical power and move on with my life? No, as well. On the other hand, writing the keyword alone is not enough. You need to elaborate more. What does that mean? So you need to write more. So the thing is, if you know what the keyword is, then the rest is easy. You just have to remember the keywords. And then from then on, it's just a matter of expansion, explaining, examples, drawing. So if you know that the electrical system equal electrical power, good to go. And then the rest is just English composition. This electrical system is all about the distribution or transmission of electrical power. For example, this and this and that. You can draw a picture if you want. It doesn't matter what you do after that. It's just creativity. But as long as that your answer includes or highlights the concept or the keyword of electrical power. Does that make sense? Now, what about here, the electronic system? What is the key power here? See, although the word electrical power is here, but it's not the answer, because it says, rather than focusing on electrical power, electronic system actually focus on, the keyword is not even here. It actually focuses on data. Actually, the keyword is not here. So the make of the electronic is basically is about the primary focus of electronic system is data and the designing of and that manage that data, that manage that data, such as make up the electronic equipment. Okay, so this is now the keyword. I apologize because this looks like an older version of the slides, but essentially this is the keyword that you need to understand about electronic system. See, electronic system is not about how much power we have, how much voltage we have, how much current we have. You see, this is electrical system. Electrical system, or if you remember, I'm not sure if you studied electrical circuits, I think you did, but in electrical circuits, you focus on, or maybe in EMS later on, the focus of EMS and electrical circuit is about how much is the current voltage, how much is the current ampere, how much is the power transmitted, and so on and so forth. So that's electrical system. But when it comes to electronic system, it's all about the data. What do you mean, data? We basically means, okay, if the value of the data is one, then the door should open. So we don't care about how much is the voltage or current or power. We just need the data, which is what is the value of the variable? Is it open or closed? Is it off or on? Is it one or zero? Or what is the value of the sensor or coming from the sensor? Is it A or B or something like that? So it's more about data and the management of the data, okay? And also how the components respond to this data. So essentially the keyword or the main difference between electrical and electronics is that electrical system is all about electrical power, whereas electronic system is all about data and the response and the management of data. See, you have a sensor, the sensor captures a set of data, then it transfers the data across electrical currents. Then when the data reaches to the controller, then based on the data, it does a certain job. Opens the door, moves the robot, closes a window, or something like that. So you see, it's based on the data, the electronic system performs and does a job. So that's why electronic system equal data, and electrical systems equal power. Okay, any questions before I move forward? Okay, let's keep going. By the way, I know that my notes and the video are here for you, but I strongly suggest that you write down your own notes as well. Writing down things by hand is the number one surefire way to remember things later on. Watching a video, although it's cool and all, it's not enough. Going back and remembering which item in which video is—it's never going to be useful or not going to be good for you. Another thing you might want to write down is the timing. And this is something of the video. Like right now, we are 4:35 of the video, or at the time. This is when I was talking about this part right here. Later on, when you want to watch this video again, you might not want to, you might not remember where or which part of the video I was talking about this topic. So you might want to create some sort of key times of the video. This is just some other hint to help you to go through the videos quickly. Okay. So again, have your own notes, reminders, and so on. Or maybe if you want the pages of the slide, so on and so forth. Okay, move on. So now let's talk about CPU and microprocessor. And once again, the difference between, let's just talk about microprocessor first. You know what? So let's just do this for a second. A microprocessor is simply a device that processes information. It receives information and processes the information. And then basically, when you hear the word process information, what does that mean? Well, process information simply means it receives input and it gives output. So based on the information it receives, it does some sort of computations, it makes decisions, and then based on those decisions, it gives out commands. Unfortunately, I forgot to bring my board, my e-pen, so usually I make notes here, scribbles, but I forgot to bring the pen. I'll bring it next time. So it's a good idea to remember things that maybe not in the slide. So what do you mean by processor? What does it do? Well, first of all, it receives info. Receive info. And then makes computation. Makes computations, AKA decisions. And then after that, gives commands. Gives commands. Of course, there are other things that the processor does, such as memory management. We can say also operating system, OS, and background processes. Let's just say that all of that stuff is the background operations, okay? Yeah, let's just do that here. So background operations. Background operations means, operating systems, OS, management, and so on. Okay, let's not get into detail into what is those things are, because this is now is turning into computer system, computer engineering. Let's just focus on the first three things, which is receive information, makes decisions, and then gives out commands. So this is usually is the input. And the input comes to the processor from a number of sources. Could be a sensor, it could be a value that you yourself gave inputted. You basically keyed in the values. And the decisions or the computation is basically what happens inside the program. You know, those if statement, the loops, the all the things that you do inside the program is essentially what the system will do. Based on the information that you have here, it will do the logic. Sometimes we call it the logic. Okay. For example, if the light is red, stop. Right? This is a logic that we all understand, right? This is a program that is already built into our processes, our brains, convention essentially. So when you're driving and you see a red light, essentially it means stop. And if you see a green light, it means go. See, right there we have information, incoming information, which is the color. And then we have made our own computation or decisions. And then we give output. Well, the command is stop. And the stop means either you physically stop in your body or you press the brakes. And this could be the output. And the output essentially is goes out to the actuators, like the motor that closes the door or the joint that moves the robot, et cetera, et cetera. So when you work with a processor, and when I say work with a processor, you basically essentially help the processor does these three jobs. First of all, capture information, process that information or, you know, make decisions, and then give commands or give output. Input, process, output. So that's essentially what you will be doing, what is going to happen inside your program. Most of the time when we work with a computer program, a controller program, you will have to do these three parts. You will have to first receive information, process that information, and then give output. Actually, there's one more step before that. It's called setup, but we'll come to that later. Okay. So that's essentially what you'll be doing with the processor later on. So that's also what a microprocessor is. A microprocessor is an integrated circuit device that consists of thousands of transistors that allows it to perform the arithmetics and the logical operations to perform these things right here. Now, the reason why you have transistors, thousands of the transistors, is because the more transistors you have, the more speed you have. In our brain, human brains, we have brain cells. The more brain cells you have, the more capability we have. As we get older, as we become, as some of us get older, they start to become less able because their brain cells start to die, unfortunately, and then they will lose their skills. Some people get injuries, they get head injuries, and then the injuries causes some of the brain cells to die, and then again they lose some of their brain power. Again, when it comes to computer power, the more transistors you have, the more capabilities you do have. Okay, that's lovely. So what is the difference between the processor and the CPU? Well, this comes down to the purpose. And in another way to look at it, a CPU is also a processor. Essentially, it also consists of, again, transistors that does the same job as you see here. Receives information, computation, and gives output. In fact, it does it. But the difference between CPU and microprocessor or processor in general is that the microprocessor is a specific or very narrow in aspect. See, when we design a controller to open or close a door, the processor will only focus on this particular task, which is essentially open and close the door. It doesn't care about anything else in the world. So the microprocessor essentially would perform a specific subtask. I know I said earlier a keyword. You don't have to use exactly the same keyword that I have here. Another way of writing this, you can say specific tasks or narrow focused tasks. These are all good. So as long as you understand the meaning that the CPU and a microprocessor usually does a specific task or tasks. Maybe it's not just open and close the door. Maybe control only the five motors only. That's it. The rest of the system, something else. So what does the CPU then do then, or the central processing unit? The central processing unit is also a processor, but it's much, much bigger because it does control this. Background operation, plenty of it, of things that you might not even know or understand yet. It contains registers, where did this thing go? Yeah, arithmetic units, logic control, language control. When you write a program in C++, the processor doesn't get C++, it gets machine language, zeros and ones. So how does that happen? How do you convert from this to that? All of that is done by the CPU as well. All kinds of math, logic, memory operations, operating system, complex system management, other programs, et cetera, et cetera. All of that is managed by the CPU. So the CPU is essentially the difference between them. Now, let's do something else here. So this is Google and microprocessor. I just want you to Google this right now. Oh, actually, it's right here, versus CPU. And actually, you can see there's a lot of discussion on that as well. And I would recommend strongly that you do this. In fact, I would recommend that you do this to all of these topics here. Do not just rely entirely on my slides, because there's plenty of information out there. You can actually get more content and more relevant content and new content. Sometimes the content is not necessarily true, but then you get more ideas. By the way, in all of this, the CPU is just this guy. In fact, it's not even this guy. This is actually the cover for it. The CPU is a smaller chip that is inside here. You know what I mean? So it's a good idea. If you want to see this in image, yeah, sure, let's go here and then click on images and you get ideas. And this right here is the microprocessor. That the whole thing is just actually, excuse me. And yeah, so the rest of it is just the board. And again, this is actually as this is actually the CPU part, but the rest of it is just a board that work with it. Okay. While we are at it, we can just do this also, microprocessor, and you can see examples of microprocessors. And if you might think about it, actually these are all CPUs as well, because the CPU is also a microprocessor. So let's see what else is there. Oh, that's a good idea. So if you can see this, so this is also an example of a microprocessor that is not a CPU, okay, or cannot operate as a CPU because it's very, very limited. Okay, so the original, the only way to work with, if you are an E&E student and you want to work with microprocessors, you will basically have to build a circuit that represents something similar to this. So microprocessor circuit. I'll show you something here. Yeah, basically this is an example of a off-the-shelf microprocessor. Then you would have to build the rest of these components yourself and to work with it. And this was the, or this is the job of the E&E students. And this was the original version of this course. We are not going to do that. We are going to work with something else. But for now, this is the meaning of microprocessor. Okay, and the CPU obviously is the difference between them is that essentially is much bigger, does a much wider job and contains much more complex operations. So you saw this word before, hardware abstraction, and I can bet you right now that it's probably 99% of this course or the people here today, if not all, have no idea what this means, hardware abstraction. This is because this concept is a software engineering concept, but it's something that you are familiar with yourself. If you remember, if you ever bring or buy a new hardware, say a new mouse or a new camera or a new anything that you want to use with your laptop, and as soon as, and before you can actually use it, you have to install a driver. Okay, this is not the 90s yet. You might need a driver or something to work with it, otherwise the hardware won't work. Have you actually seen that before? I know that some nowadays with Windows Advance, all of the drivers are automatically installed upon first time installation, but some devices, some unique devices, you may need to install a driver first before you can use the device correctly. Anyone familiar with the situation? Yeah. Well, what does the driver do then? The driver actually essentially is a computer program. It does what it actually it does the following jobs. These jobs right here. It properly connects the elements of the hardware into the CPU or the processing unit of the PC. It probably connects the sensors and to the controllers. If you remember, in a electromechanical system, you have devices that captures information and you have devices that receives information. So this is basically how it connects between them. It installs the hardware library in case if there is any, and it includes the library into the main program, and it sets out input-output relationships. By the way, this we will do later ourselves. So this is basically what hardware abstraction is. And in fact, the reason why I'm introducing it here, because when we work with Arduino later on, the very first part of your program will be hardware abstraction when you do the setup. I mean, that's where we're going to be doing in the beginning. Okay, let me finish these three slides, and then we can take a short break because they are very short slides, and then we can actually take a small break. Okay, so next point or next thing to discuss is an algorithm versus a program. And I'm sure that you're familiar with all of those, you have seen them before, but it's very important to understand the difference. And it's also important to know how an algorithm is actually going to help you develop very good programs. I'm sure you all know what a program is or what it does look like. In case I can show you a program right now. So let me open up Genie. This is actually a program called Genie. An IDE called Genie. Yeah, really, the Genie in a bottle, right? Genie. And essentially, this is a program. If you look at the program, and you can see that it's full of. You might notice that this is someone's submission. Yes, it's indeed it is, and you will be developing something like that later on. But for now, the program essentially looks like this. Essentially, it's a bunch of syntax, a bunch of commands, a bunch of functions that you're going to create. But if you look at this program right now, it won't make any sense to you right now. You won't understand what's going on. You'll have to learn the language first, excuse me, and then understand how it works. And for that, it's going to be a huge confusion for you. So that's what the meaning of a program is. A program essentially is a set of instructions, computer instructions, that is given to the processor, not to you. However, an algorithm essentially is a set of actions, the same instructions, but they are written in human language. And this is the key word here. Essentially, the algorithm achieves the same job as the program, but it's written in your own language. So if I write an algorithm, say in English, and if you understand English, you'll understand it. If I write an algorithm in Arabic and you understand Arabic, you'll get it. If you write it in Malay and Chinese and any other language. In other words, it's a human language. It's not a syntax. It's not a program. An example of an algorithm is something that we do every day. It's right here. This is the traffic light algorithm. If light is red, stop the car. You don't have to put the arrow or is or whatever. I know this looks sounds almost like an F statement. You don't have to write it this way. You just write, if the light is red, then stop the car. That's also an algorithm. What you're looking at right now actually is something called sudo program or sudo algorithm. P-S-U-D-U-E. And essentially, sudo means almost a program. It's not a program. It's definitely not proper syntax. But it's written in some way that you would understand as a human. If you understand the human language in which it's written, you can write an algorithm in whichever language you like, as long as you understand it. And then once you're happy with the algorithm, then it's just a matter of converting the algorithm into a program. That is why I would strongly suggest, and I would say it again, I would strongly suggest, when you start your program writing journey, do not immediately start writing the program. It's going to be difficult for you to do it. What I would suggest is to start by writing the algorithm first. Write your program in human language, in your own words. What do you want the program to do? And then once your algorithm is there, once you can see it, then it's just a matter of converting the algorithm into a program by simply switching to the proper syntax. Syntax is the next slide. I'll get to it in a minute. Of course, we will do this later on ourselves together in our later chapters. But I just wanted to tell you right now that it's a proper way of writing programs, especially for beginners, even for advanced developers. Because sometimes when you write it in an algorithm, it's easy to see everything in one shot, and then it's easier to modify the code later on or update it or whatever. You can actually see a whole picture of the program. You won't miss anything. Also, when you write an algorithm for the first time, you won't get bugged with errors. If you are a beginner, you're going to get a lot of errors, and then you're going to lose the focus. You don't know what the program is doing because you get a lot of errors, and you can't focus on the program. You're focusing on the errors, and so on and so forth. So once you have the algorithm ready, it's just a matter of conversion, and we will do that later on. What is a syntax? The best way to describe the word syntax is grammar. think about the word grammar in your language. And every language in the world, every human language in the world, whether it's English, Arabic, French, science, whatever, right? Every language have a set of rules or grammar. You must follow these rules in order for other people to understand what you're saying. If you speak Arabic and you break the grammar rules, we might still understand you, but we would know, you know, that your language is broken. Or we might, if you break the rules so much, we might not even understand you whatsoever. In computer world, the word syntax simply means the rules or the grammar rules. Every programming language have a syntax. So Python has a syntax rules, C++, Java, Android, and so on and so forth. So in order for you to make sure that you converted the algorithm into a program, you must follow the syntax rules. So how do you know, or where do you can find the rules? Well, we have to go and use online resources. And in fact, apart from these resources, I'm going to show you a very powerful resources which we are going to use ourselves. And that is W3 schools. Yeah. So W3 schools. Okay. W3 schools is a very powerful online resources for programming languages. And we are going to use it. In fact, my slides or my content for the C++ slides and the Python slides are actually taken from here. And as you can see, you can learn anything you want, really, but we're not going to do all of that. We're only going to do two languages, which is Python and C++. So you can actually come here and say CPP, which is C++. You can write C++ like this. That will still work. And then here we go. And you're going to come to the CPP tutorial. And in fact, we will actually use this to do this. And we can actually, in my slides, actually, the chapter 4 and 5 about C++ actually contains these, but not all of them because we don't have the time, but majority of them. You know what I mean? So we will use the same thing, but for Python, which is right here. And again, we have this in our tutorial and in our contents later on. And this is it. This is the first chapter of this course, which is the foundation chapter. What else is here? Let me go through this again. The notes, yeah. The notes, I think it's also a summary of the slides. Let's take a look at it. I do have it on my computer. I just don't know where it is right now. So let me open up the file. Oh, it's more elaborate. Oh, that's very good, because some of you might be thinking, oh, the slides are not detailed enough, but well, here we go. So some of this we haven't talked about yet, which is the difference between Python and C. That will come later. IoT versus the internet. Again, that will come later. But then we did talk about online resources. We talked about algorithm. We talked about what's ENE. We talked about CPU versus microcontroller, and so on and so forth. You know what I mean? So this is basically what the content of the notes is. So so that's basically what I meant by the slides and the notes. We're gonna go for a small break, and then after the break, we're gonna talk about IoT, the second chapter right here. We're going to start with it. We're not going to be able to finish it all. We're going to do as much as we can. And then next week we will finish it. And then we will also finish this section as well. Okay. So let's take 5 and I'll see you in 5 minutes. I'm going to mute my mic and remove the screen share. And I'll see you in 5:05. Okay, and welcome back. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
So let's continue. So now we talk about the second chapter, which is the Internet of Things. Before you can work with the Internet of Things, before you build your system of the Internet, which you will do, by the way, by the end of the semester, you will need to understand what it is and what can you do about it and how you can actually make it work for you. How can you get involved with it? How can you make it your own, sort of speak? You know what I mean? So, well, let's get going. So what we're going to talk about in this section, not necessarily all today, we're going to understand what is the meaning of the Internet. What is, in order for you to understand IoT, you need to understand Internet. And I know this sounds funny. We all know what the Internet is, but that's not what I meant. Well, that's not what it means here. We mean, some of you might even know how the Internet works. Some of you don't. So I know what the Internet is. I go to online, Google, and we go. Actually, no. What happens behind the scenes? When you go to a browser and you type something there, you type Google or the address, what happens behind the scene? So that's, excuse me, what we're going to talk about now, which is the Internet itself. How does it work? Because if you understand that part, don't worry, we're not going to go into detail or depth. We're not going to do network engineering here, but we're going to understand some basics. And if you understand those basics, then this will make sense, which is the IoT framework. The IoT framework essentially is the components or the elements that makes the thing that we call Internet of Things. What is it all about? How does it work? And so on. And then you'll also understand that there are differences of IoT applications. There are different types for different applications. For beginners like you guys, when you think of the word applications, you might think, oh, agriculture application, industry application. No, that's not what I meant. In the same industry, say agriculture, we might have different applications for IoT. We might be using the IoT for field management. We might be using it for monetary purposes. So for these different applications, we might need a different versions or types of IoT. The next step is, or the next thing we're going to talk about is the potential of IoT. What do you mean by potential? See, some of you might have some idea what IoT is and therefore its benefits. But you, some of you or majority of you might not have the full idea of what IoT can do for you or for us, what the real benefits of the IoT and how can it actually be useful for us, or for not just us as persons, but also as industries or even as countries. How can it do? What can it do? And why the big deal about what's the big deal and why is it everywhere we go? But also you will learn the challenges. You might have known all of the above about IoT, but then you would come to the point where you want to implement IoT onto your system, onto your industry or your company, whatever, right? Then you come across the challenges. If you are not familiar with those challenges, but if you're not ready for those challenges, you may not be able to implement IoT altogether, or you might implement it, but it will be limited, and therefore you will not realize the full potential of it. And that's why before you actually begin any IoT system development, you need to understand the potentials versus the challenges, and then how you can overcome the challenges in order to realize or achieve the potentials. And then finally, I'll show you some IoT success stories. These are done by your seniors, our students just like you, third year engineering students, mechanical, yeah, who build and won design awards. I'm not trying to showboast here. I'm not trying to show off, but I can tell you that since October 2017, basically 1 year after I started working on IoT. Since that month, October of 2017, until February this year, which is when the MCO started, for all of these years, every semester, consistently, I have won, a student of mine has won a Best Project Award in Uniten, whether it's Capstone Team, FYP Project, and so on and so forth, consistently every semester. I'm not trying, the reason why I bring this up is not to show off, but to tell you that every one of those winners, they have used IoT. Every one of them is maybe one or two only. They use automation, which is my other part of research, which is robotics and automation. But the majority of the works that won Best Project Award involved IoT in one way or another. So that's why I'm telling you about the potential and the success stories. And some of these students graduated and worked, and some of them continued with me as master students, and they continued to win awards. They won industrial awards, they won international design awards, golden awards outside of the university, I mean national and international levels, again with my projects and under my supervision. So again, to tell you how big this the IoT world is. So let's go over it. So I think today we have roughly about maybe half an hour. Yeah, I think about half an hour, 35 minutes to go. So we might not be able to cover, maybe we can reach only up to here, maybe the first two items only, and then we can move on, we can stop, and then the rest of it we can cover next class. So let's talk about the internet, the way you know it. So here's your laptop, and here's your, I don't know why a laptop and a desktop are like this, but I just ignore it. I think this is a modem. So this is a laptop, this is a modem, and this is your physical device that connects you to the internet. This is a satellite network or the internet tower or whatever, right? And this is the on the other side, and this is what we call the internet. Now, behind the scene, what's going on is this. Essentially, the easiest way to understand the idea of the internet is that imagine two computers connected by wires, because that's exactly how the internet started in the mid 80s. It was a network of connected computers in a company. I forgot the name of the company, Dell or Texas Instruments. I forgot which one of these. But they eventually they created the network of computers by simply connecting them. And then they realized that they want to connect other computers in a different building. And that building was far away. So they realized that it's just a matter of wiring. And then they thought, wait a minute, we can do wireless radio. Why not wireless data? And this is where they did achieve that. They had to develop a number of protocols and stuff like that. And then expanded on and on until it becomes the international network, AKA internet. International network or the internet is essentially a network of connected computers. So how does the internet work? And I know that we don't have to go into depth into the protocol or internet protocols, but from our perspective for today, you need to understand a few concepts. Number one, every computer on the internet has a unique address. You know it already, it's called the IP address. And I know the IP address is not as simple as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, but just take it as an example. Every computer on the internet or every hotspot or every browser or every device has its own unique IP address. And that IP address is needed to identify every different machines. Now, when you actually go to the internet yourself and you go and open Firefox or you go open Chrome or any other browser device, you are actually using what is called an internet client. An internet client is an application that is used or allow you to access the internet. And the word client here is very important to capture. Because client, we're going to use, I know the word client in English means customer, but in the internet world, client simply means receiver of data. So you are, when you actually go and browse Google or any other application or Facebook or whatever service or application that you want, you have to use a client. And the client is not you, by the way. The client is the application. Chrome, which is the internet browser, is a client. Your Android app is a client. Your email application is a client. Your Netflix application is a client. Every one of these clients have a different feature, but they all do the same job. They allow you to receive information. Okay? The browser allows you to receive information about other things on the internet. A YouTube application allows you to receive videos. Netflix allows you to watch shows. Facebook allows you to socialize or to see information from other people. You know what I mean? But in all of these applications, the concept is the same. You are using an application, and that application could be on a laptop, on a desktop, on an Android device, on a wearable, on a car, on an Android car, or whatever actually device that is connected to the internet. As long as you are using a client, and that client will give you a service, and that service will use some data from the internet. Okay? So if you are a client, or excuse me, if you are using a client and you're asking for information, where does information come from? Well, when you actually go and type google.com, you are actually sending a request through the internet. And that request is telling the internet, telling them, you know what, I want to go to a certain, I want to open a certain page that is actually stored on the location called Google. Google.com. So what is actually the protocol will do is going to go to the server on the other side. Server, now I am very sure that you've heard this word before, and you probably understand the concept of a server. But once again, let's be on the same page today and agree that in terms of internet protocol, a server essentially is another application that its only purpose is to serve the data that you requested from your client. So once again, you started the process from the client, you made the request on your device, and through the internet protocol, it went through the other device on the other side, because it's based on the IP address that you identified, and then a server application answered your request and provided you with the information. So it takes the information, you typed google.com, so the request go there, it goes to its list of application or pages, it will take the information that is supposed to be shown on the google.com page, which is the logo, the search bar, and other things that you see on the page, and then it will send it to you. So when I go to the browser now, right here, and I click on, google.com, I'm actually making a request. And when it goes to the, what happened just now is that that request went to the server, and it got me this information, the picture here, the search bar, the I feel lucky, and so on and so forth, and it sent it back to me. So I just received all of this information. And this is actually, I'm sure maybe a lot of you already understand this concept of the internet, maybe not. But the reason why I went through this, because in order for you to understand what IoT is, you have to have a full understanding of what I just said, of what the concept of a client, the concept of internet protocols. So once again, when you actually go to the browser, when you yourself as the person use a your device, whether it's a laptop or an Android or a phone or an iPhone, whatever, right? And you access the internet, you have to use an application that is usually called a client. So when do we ever? But sometimes, so we upload stuff to the internet. Yes, you're right. When you go to Facebook, sometimes you upload an image or you down or you write a post. That's fine, because in this case, you still use a client, but that client allows you the features of sending information to the server. And that information that you just uploaded, that image, that the post and the likes and all of that stuff, will be stored in the server or in the computers of the server. Essentially, a server is a hardware computer that contains blocks of memory. That's basically it. Just like your laptop, when you on your laptop, you have files, you have compute, you have images, and you have videos and music and programs and a bunch of other stuff. And a server essentially is also a computer just like yours, but of course it's a much more capable computer and much bigger memories and stuff like that. So all the uploads that you have, your text, your file, your images, and all the stuff that you send to Facebook, for example, it goes to a server and then it's stored there. And then if you would like to see it, you go to another version of the client and you request your page or somebody else's page, and then you see their content. The same thing with email, but the concept of the email is quite, basically you'll have to imagine another client here. When you send an email, you open your email client, let's say Yahoo or Gmail, right? And you write an email and then you send. When it doesn't really go to the other guy, it simply goes to the server. The server then sends a notification to the other guy and says, you have an email. So the guy on the other side essentially will have to, again, from his side, access the same client, the email client, and go and request the email. And that's how email works. So far, so good. Any question about this so far, about what you see in front of you, about the concept of the internet? I know that the internet is far more complex than this, but we are not network engineers, so I don't have to go into further details. Now, what's left? The other thing that is missing from here is internet protocol. The internet protocol essentially are, think of it like the syntax, our governing rules. These are the rules that manage the how the information is processed and transferred through the internet. So if this is the case, then essentially it manages how IP addresses are defined and allocated, et cetera, et cetera. So let's not get into detail into the protocols. We just want to understand the concept of a client, server, and your computer and the other guy's computer, and then the fact that you are human here using this device and another human is saving or storing this information for other people to use. Okay, any questions about this so far? Okay, so now based on this understanding of the internet itself, let's talk about the IoT itself. Now, the IoT uses similar protocols, but we actually, by the way, let me just change this to this. So can you see the pointer? Yeah? Okay. So now the internet that we saw before, right? No, I don't want to give control. Okay, so the internet that you see here, right? Essentially, the one we saw here, right? Essentially, you have a browser and you have a server and essentially the receipt before. Now, this is now how the IoT works. Now, before we see how the IoT works, let's understand the elements of how the IoT, the elements of the IoT. First of all, the first element of the IoT is the IoT device itself. The word IoT means Internet of Things. Well, first you need the thing. And this is the device that actually what we call the thing. And the IoT device or the thing, essentially most of the time is what we call a network sensor or a sensor, or let's just call it data gathering device. And this device captures information. And because it's connected to the internet, it captures the raw data and then send it to the internet or broadcast it to the servers. The same way you did it yourself when you go and upload the information. Well, in this case, it's a device on its own. It's a sensor, really. It's a device that captures, like a microphone, for example. You can think of a microphone as a sensor. It captures your voice, but it's also connected to an internet. Think of a microphone that is connected to a modem. It captures a voice and then it sends the voice to the internet automatically. So that's basically how the thing works. Now, the information that receives or goes to the server, it could be raw information. And therefore, that information need to be processed, need to be organized, and need to be improved. So this is where data processing is. Now, when we say servers, we mean all of the internet stuff, like what the data is used for, and so on and so forth. But then the data needs to be processed. Once the data is processed, then it then goes to be viewed, shown to the client, shown to the person, to us. So essentially, this is now how the Internet of Things work. You have a raw data source, which is the device or the thing. You can imagine that this is the server. This is the source of information. And then over here is data analytics, is where we process the information, make sense of it. And then once the processed data is here, then we send it to the IoT client. Now, I hope now you understand what IoT client is. We discussed earlier what is a client. Email client, like Gmail, YouTube is a client, browser is a client, your Netflix application is a client. Even right now, we are here using Teams, right? Teams is a client, right? These all applications are called clients because they provide you with a service, with a sort of a feature. Same thing with IoT clients. IoT clients essentially is an application that allows you to view the processed and even the raw data if you want. So think of the IoT client as the application or device, application or system that allows you to browse or watch or see the information. But it's not only for watching, it's not a movie, okay? You could use the IoT client to do more than just showing. You could use it to create, to do other things, which we will discuss in a minute. So far, so good. Any question up to this point? I think I'm gonna go ahead.
No, sir.
Thank you. So essentially, this is again, I'm not gonna go any further. I'm gonna actually stop. Still early. Let's keep going. So the principal elements of the IoT framework, a device for capturing or gathering raw data. It could be as simple as a sensor plus a network card. We call it sometimes network sensor. It could be as complex as an electromechanical system that captures a set of information and then uses this information locally. I'll give you another example of that is, you know what, I'm gonna tell you the first ever thing or the first ever Internet of Thing device was a vending machine. And this was, by the way, I'm not sure if it's in the slides, no? Yeah, it's here. The vending machine example was, let's say you own the company that runs the vending machine, okay? And you put the machine in our building here in Unitan, but your company headquarters is in PJ. For those who don't know, PJ is roughly about 40 minutes drive from here. So it's quite a journey. So you are in PJ, about 40 minutes away from here, and you don't know what's going on with your machine in Unitan. Is it full? Is it finished? Do I have to send someone to refill the machine? What happens if I send someone and they travel 40 minutes, spend time and fuel, only to find out the machine is still full? So that was a wasted journey. Is that right? Or let's say I don't go. I don't send someone that often, right? And then I go tomorrow and I realize the machine, or maybe next week, and I realize the machine was empty and it was running empty for nearly a week. And we have been wasting, revenue by not putting anything in the machine, and we are using and wasting electrical current and so on and so forth. You know what I mean? There is no way to predict the behavior of the machine because it depends on the situation in around the machine. Maybe there is traffic, maybe there is people, so therefore there is more. So the company has no choice but to send regular visits and hit and miss kind of thing. If the guy goes there and the machine is full, that's a loss. But if it's half full, just fill whatever you can. Basically, it's the procedure is filled with a lot of wastage. Imagine a situation where the vending machine can tell you exactly the status of the bottles inside it. You can actually imagine a situation where the guy in, and by the way, I mean, this is just one machine. Imagine if the company doesn't have just one machine. Imagine if the company has 100 machines scattered around Malaysia. How are you going to send the guy or the drivers to go around all of these machines to fill them up? How do you know which one is empty, which one is not empty? And if you're going to send the guy to go through all of these 100 machines every day, you're going to spend a lot of money on fuel alone, on servicing the car that or the truck, and on salary for this guy because he had to travel every day, a billion miles every day, right? And imagine that even though you're sending the guy every day, you're spending a lot of money on that, and you're still not efficient enough because the guy can still travel to every machine. And imagine the situation where even though the guy traveled to every machine every day, but they're still full. So I'm spending a lot. Imagine you are the owner of the company and you're spending a lot of money on this situation and you're still not getting enough revenue. So imagine a situation where all of these machines that you have, you are already connected to them all in real time. And you can therefore monitor the situation of these machines. You can know exactly the status of every machine. you can find out which machine is about to be finished, and therefore you can target your machines. So instead of sending the driver to every machine in around your network, instead send it only to where it's needed. So less journeys, less fuel, less money wasted, right? Also, you always have revenue because your machines will not be wasted. You will only focus your resources to where they are needed. Is that right? But that's not all. And this is only one example of IoT. Imagine if you can find out which drink is more popular than the others, because you can tell which one or which drink finishes faster than the others, because you know you can monitor every drink in every machine. So you can actually find out which one is more popular than the others, and therefore you can actually have more of that drink, therefore maximize your revenue. You can even identify the behavior of your people around your machines. You can actually monitor them in real time over an extended period of time, and then therefore you can develop trends. You can know from behavior that usually during certain times or during certain parts of the year or parts of the month, your demand increases a lot compared to other times. So based on that information, you can focus your resources more. You can increase the number of machines. You can also identify which locations are more responsive or more business than others. And therefore, you can add more machines, reduce more machines, and so on and so forth. And this is still not even all. Imagine your customer behavior information can be useful to others. See, for example, if you identify a location, let's say in Unit 10, and you identify the behavior of the people that, you know what, every Monday, there will be 100 orders. There will be 100 people at the machine getting drinks. So you know for sure that every Monday, for example, yeah, that every Monday, there's 100 people near the machine on that day. Imagine if you take that information and you give it to another business nearby the machine, and you tell him, you know what, every Monday there will be 100 people in front of your shop. Obviously, that guy would love to know that information, because therefore that guy then can focus on those increased customers. He can put more stuff at the shop, maybe put more sandwiches and stuff like that. So therefore, he knows that his business will increase. Or maybe you would know that there is a lot of traffic continuously near a certain location. So you would know that, you know, what I'm trying to tell you is that the information about your water business or your drink business can be useful for other people. So those other people would pay money just to know the behavior or the customer behavior around their locations. So therefore, they can benefit as well. And you also can benefit. The information that you collected from the machine becomes a commodity, and you can sell. And this becomes a business on its own. So not only you make money from your drinks, but you can also make money by knowing the behavior of your customers and selling that information to the other people. So this is essentially are all the potentials of IoT. So now this is what I meant by an electromechanical system that uses information and then capture and uses that information locally. Data analytics. Now, once again, let's get back to the slide. So the three primary elements of IoT framework: a device to capture information, a data analytics, which is essentially a program or an algorithm to process raw data into meaningful information. And there's plenty of ways we can do that, and we will do that. And then finally, an effective IoT client for viewing, controlling, and or both. Meaning, I can from the office, I can view what's going on in every machine. I can, from my office, switch off a machine. I can know, say, for example, I noticed that one machine, there is no business. Nobody is there. So I realize that this machine is empty. So I know that we're not going to have any refill visits today or tomorrow, weekend or something like that. So I switch off the machine from here, from my office. I don't have to travel to switch it off. I don't have to waste electricity, and so on and so forth. So this is basically can be done remotely as well through the internet. Okay, so the principal elements. So you see, the Internet of Things can be used to do two things. You can actually watch, you are here, you are using the IoT client to to watch the information that's sent from the internet, the device or the thing. So basically you are watching the device, but at the same time you can also send commands to the device. By the way, the picture you are watching right now, this right here, taken from one of my IoT projects where we developed an IoT camera for a TV studio. In fact, TV Al Hijra, if you heard about it. We actually built it and we demonstrated it in their studios. In that system, you can actually control a camera, a TV camera, remotely from your laptop through the internet, where it can actually remotely watch a scene and film a scene, and you can be the director from wherever you are as long as you're connected. I'll show you more on this later. So I think I'm gonna stop here. Basically, talk about these two because I already explained this concept, and then I'm gonna stop at this slide. So the potential of IoT is, we talked about how you can reduce costs and make the process more efficient. Remember the example of the vending machine? Rather than travel to every machine 100 times every day and waste a lot of money and time and resources, we can then focus only where we need it. So this is actually one of the first reasons why IoT was actually developed in the first place, which is process streamlining, improve the efficiency, reduce costs, and therefore increase productivity, and therefore increase profits. So that is the number one and primary, and still until today, the primary use and major application or purpose of IoT. But that is not the only reason. Another primary or becoming more and more very important reason is integration. You see, if you go back a couple of slides, you see this process data, before it goes or apart from sending it to the client, we can also send it to another platform. We can send it to a robot. We can send it to another system altogether. And that information can be used to work with other technologies. And that is what is meant by integration. There are plenty of current and emerging technologies nowadays. Have you heard about something called blockchains or blockchain, cryptocurrency or something like that? So these things, they also require data. Cloud-based robotics or Internet of Things or IoT robotics. These are robots that you capture the information that is captured by the sensors or by the network sensors and use that information to perform their jobs. Like, for example, search and rescue robots that work together. So the information, they apart from sending the information to us, the human to watch, they also send it to each other. And then based on that information they share, they can then coordinate their actions. And finally, this is what I meant by monetizing the data. See, the data that you have captured from your sensors could become a commodity on its own. Consumer behaviors. I know, I'm not sure if you fully understand how Google makes money. It's and also how Facebook makes money is basically about user data. And I know you've heard about user data and privacy and all of that issue, but we are not talking about user data here. We're talking about user behavior, or at least device behavior. That behavior, that device could be useful for other industry other than yours. And therefore, it's important for you to know other things. I'll give you another example of I'll show you another example. Oh, yeah, this is another example of monetizing data, but I think we'll discuss that next class. So I think good enough for today. It's 5:40, not exactly 10 minutes to go, but I think enough theory for today. So a little bit of recap. So what we discussed today was a refresher of the internet. Actually, there is something missing here, which is the different types of IoT application. I'm not sure if I missed it or I jumped it. Oh, it is here. Oh no, I think I know what's going on. There is one slide missing, unfortunately. So let me write it here. I guess this is the extra 10 minutes. So the different types of IoT application. Not sure if this is actually Should be here. I remember it's. No, it's not. I guess I missed it, or at least it's not in this slide. So let's do it. I'm going to write it down from memory. So the first type is obviously is there are four types of IoT applications. So the first one is which is remote monitoring. This one is, we already discussed it, and the example of remote monitoring is essentially when you remotely monitor, say, for example, your vending machine or your agriculture application or your search and rescue robot. Or this is what you meant here, is where the information goes from the device to you, so you are remotely monitoring it. You have to understand that this picture looks like or feels like they are in the same room, but actually they're not. Could be in different countries altogether. And as long as they are both connected to the internet, so this guy can remotely monitor the device. See, the vending machine, we are here, and the vending machine could be in Singapore. We can still monitor it as long as they're connected and all the protocols are correctly set up. Oh, wait, this is the wrong slides. So let's get back to the correct slides. Remote monitoring and remote controlling. And remote controlling is obviously is when you remotely can control the machine, which is right here. The procedure actually goes the other way. Through the client, the user can actually click a button or turn a switch, an app switch, like a slide something or close up or click on something. And that command will go in the other direction through the internet, go to the device, and then the device will do something based on that. So for example, you could actually send the command to your device to close the door or to open a gate or something like that. Through basically the arrow will be in the opposite direction. So that will be remote controlling. Of course, combinations of both. It could be obviously both of these. And also the last one is device to device. Device, or maybe a better way to say it is thing to thing. Thing to thing. Thing to thing is, imagine that we have another sensor here, and these two are exchanging information, and based on information captured by each other, they can then do their job without any interference from the human, apart from just watching the system. Maybe sensor A will capture a certain situation, and based on that, sensor B will stop working or something like that. Or like I said earlier, in the search and rescue robot working together. Maybe one search robot has covered already one area, so it sends the notification to the other robots that, you know what, this area has been cleared, you don't have to come here, so we're good to go. So that's an example of device to device. So once again, the four different types of internet or things systems are right here. Remote monitoring, remote controlling, combinations of monitoring and controlling, and then thing-to-thing systems. Of course, it could be a combination of, the above. So let's put that here. Combinations here. Is that smaller? Okay, so basically that's the different types of IoT things. You know what I mean? So remote monitoring, remote controlling, thing to things, or if you would like, device to device, device to device, and then combinations of the above. Okay, so that's, I think, yeah, that's more or less time. So we talked about IoT framework, different types of applications, potentials of IoT. Briefly discuss that, but we will talk more about it, and then the challenges. In the next class, we will finish this part, which is challenges, and discuss, shows more about success stories. And then we're going to talk about embedded systems and how to work with them. Any questions so far? Can you follow the concepts that we discussed? Any questions about those?
Yeah, so you can follow.
Okay, that's great. So, but anyway, if you have any questions and you're too shy to ask here, you can definitely put your questions in a Telegram group. Okay, Please do not send a private question because I don't want to repeat it myself. You can send me a private messages if you want, not a problem. But if it's something about you only, and it's a private, it's a general. If it's a generic question like how to register or how to open this or whatever, right? So please ask in a group. But if it's something about your situation, like your individual assignment or something like that, then yeah, sure, no problem. You can message me directly. Okay. So all good. Any questions? Any other questions?
For the midterm test, sir.
One at a time. You go ahead. For the midterm.
For the midterm test, sir. Will it be conducted during class?
Yes.
Okay.
We will take one of ours. I can see your point now, because we have two sessions, right? It's too early for that anyway. I'll think about it. Maybe I will run two sessions, one for each section. Or maybe I will run one unified session for both sections at the same time. Either way, I'll let you know.
All right.
What's the other guy was asking? There was someone else. Any other questions? Somebody was about to say something.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you. Everything is clear.
Yeah, you're very welcome. You're very welcome, of course, everyone. And once again, if you have any further questions about the syllabus, I suggest you first go through the material first, and you are more than welcome, and actually you're encouraged to use online resources. There is no right and wrong answer as long as you explain it correctly. Let me rephrase that. There is a wrong answer if it doesn't contain the keywords, but as long as the keywords are there and you know how to elaborate, then we're good to go. Okay. All right, so I guess this is it. So thank you very much, guys, for this. I'll see you next week when we finish the foundational stuff. And until next time, take care and have a good day. Assalamu alaikum.
Sir?
Yes?
How to register for the attendance?
QR code. Are you familiar with the QR code?
Yes, but where can I find it?
I already shared it in the Telegram group. And by the way, you're running out of time, because it won't be accessible soon. It's in the Telegram group. I already shared it. It's a PDF file. Where is that thing go? It's not here. And then basically you'll have to scan it using your QR reader from your app, and then it will take your registration. It's in the group somewhere. I shared it earlier this morning, and it will be accessible only until 6 o'clock, so you better hurry. If you are in section 2, that you have from 3 until 6 today to use the code, otherwise you will count as absent. So.
Okay, sir, I found it. Thank you.
Okay, good. So if you found it, go ahead and use it. For anyone else who forgot to use it, go ahead and use it as quickly as possible. Okay. For those from section 1 who are here today, don't forget that you still have to do the QR thingy on on Friday during your actual time. Okay, any other questions before I close the shop? Okay, thank you very much, guys. Have a good evening, and assalamu alaikum.